about 100 years ago. It wasn't called fitness back then, it was called physical culture. Today, people walk up to each other and they ask, how much do you bench? Back then, it was, how much do you bench press? It was that important of a lift. It was the lift that so many people did for competition, to compare against each other, that sort of thing. Competitive weightlifting, in the beginning, it was all over the map. Any weight, any lift could be a competitive lift. Every Olympics, for the first 5 or 6 Olympics, the weightlifts changed every time. It could be a one-arm lift, it could be a two-arm lift, nobody knew. It wasn't organized until the late 20s when they finally decided on the clean jerk, the press, and the snatch. But once they organized the weightlifts, then a lot of lifts sort of disappeared. Once the clean and jerk and the snatch became really dominant as the competitive lifts, you lost the bench press, you lost the one-arm snatch, you lost back lifts and all these cool things that sort of disappeared. So what we're going to do is we're going to move around this weight. And for now, it doesn't matter how heavy the weight is, because we're going to practice the movement first. But the bent press was how you could move the most weight possible from shoulder to overhead with one arm. More than a jerk, more than a push, anything like that. It was getting the most weight into this position, if you're good at it. These days, nobody's really good at it, but it's fun to practice anyway. But back then, people could do way more weight with bent press than they could anything else. This is a weird lift. It's not a natural feeling lift. Nobody does a bent press and goes, oh, I got it. It's sort of like learning a martial art. It better feel unnatural in the beginning, but then you get better and better at it. We're not actually pressing. Despite the name, bent press, there's no actual press. You're never pushing it away from you. You're getting away from the weight. And this is very unique. Now we see this in clean and jerks and snatches, we get underneath the weight. There's a moment where the weight's suspended and we have to drop under it. In this though, it's not a fast lift, it's a slow grind. And it involves, even though it's called a press, it involves a great deal of your lats. And I'm going to really cue this a lot. I want you to think that you're holding something in your armpits, and I usually use a troll. I want you to think that you're squishing a troll in your armpits. I call it squishing the troll. Driving it into my ribcage there. Squishing that troll. Oh, troll blood's just screaming down my ribcage right now. I'm holding on to that. I have a slight turn in my feet. If you guys have ever done a windmill, kettlebellers, if you've done a windmill, similar hip drive, similar foot position. Now, if you look at all the old literature on bent press, you're gonna hear all sorts of stories of how wide your feet should be and all that stuff. Just put them a little bit diagonal from you, boom, lock that lat in place, get the hips back. Now, what's gonna happen here is I'm gonna continue to push my hips back. And remember, when I say back, I don't mean directly sideways. Just like a windmill, they go back a little bit, in line with the heels. But here's the thing I'm actually gonna think about. I'm gonna come away from this. My chest is gonna come away from this. If you put your finger right on this weight, it doesn't go anywhere, it rotates. Doesn't go anywhere. I go as far as I can. Now if that's as far as I can hinge at the hips, then I can squat a little bit. Boom. And then I stand up. Looks weird, right? I'm never gonna push against his finger. I can rotate around his finger. And I'm never gonna push against it, but I'm also never gonna come away from it. His finger, you're locked in space right there. My goal is to keep it right there, get away from it, boom. And then I can push his finger, boom. Don't worry, in the beginning it's gonna feel weird. I'm gonna talk you through it many, many times. In the beginning, that plate might go all over the place. You might bring it with you, you might try to push it away. Your lats are on, try to keep the lats on, squish. The booty goes out and back, underneath that elbow. You're actually almost resting that elbow or digging that elbow into your hip. There you got it. And then very gently come away from that weight. You take your hips back, look up at it, and when you get to a certain point, start to squat. If your arm's not straight yet, go ahead and squat. And then stand on it with it. Long-term goal, as I mentioned earlier, is you can do more weight this way if you're good at it than any other way. Start lighter than you can press for now, strict press. But eventually our goal today is to see if we can go heavier than you can strict press. So if we can get under that sucker, if you can strict press it, well, you can just press it. Well, I want it to be a little bit heavier than that eventually, so you have to get under it. Sure, you can push press it or jerk press it too, but for today's purposes, it might be fun to see if you can drive under it.
Because you're going to feel some parts of your body that you've never quite been aware of. And the biggest thing I want you to be really concerned with is those lats. Digging in. If your lats aren't on fire, you're not holding that thing in place. So you got to find those lats, and the rest of you is just getting under that sun.
So once that lat is locked and my hips are out, I can keep pushing this back. Look up at it, I'm corkscrewing under it. Right here, I want to squat a little because I can't go any further with my hips. Boom. Then I can stand up. If I lock tight, hips out, I can keep pushing my hips back. Notice I'm looking up at it, and then I drop